And welcome to worship at West Concord. Although we are not all at West Concord right now, we're together online. And it's amazing how modern technology today can take Facebook, YouTube, and all these online things and turn them into churches. I think that's pretty cool, especially with what we're dealing with. So we're going to continue this afternoon or this morning talking about the spirit of joy set free. We're going to continue in our study of Philippians. And over the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about humility. We've been talking about how humility and joy actually go together. We often don't think of them that way because we think of humility as something that is unpleasant. Being humbling is difficult. And yes, it's painful. We looked at Jesus last week as the pattern of our humility. And Jesus certainly went through a tremendous amount of pain to the point of being crucified, to the obedience of death. And yet he was raised and exalted by God and experienced joy that we cannot even imagine. But when we talk about humility, we oftentimes focus on the concept, but more often than not, we don't talk about how to practice it. So that's what we're going to do today. We're going to talk about how to practice it. We're going to talk about how to actually do humility in our lives, actually how to be humble. And Paul is going to help us with that as he writes this letter from prison, as he is humbled yet sharing his joy. So before we start, we're going to have a word of prayer. So would you bow with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the time together. And Lord, although we cannot be together physically, we thank you that through the wonders of technology, we can still be together via video. And Lord, I pray for our church family. Father, I pray that as we go through these difficult times, that you would continue to strengthen us, that you would continue to bless us, and that, Father, we would not try to figure it out, but humble ourselves before you and surrender ourselves to your will. Lord, knowing that you love us, that you want the best for us, and one way or another, you will see us through. Lord, bless each family watching, bless each person watching, and Father, we pray that we would all get a blessing from your word today. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So when we talk about humility, one of the greatest authors of the Christian faith, in my opinion, Andrew Murray, he was a South African pastor, teacher, and missionary. And he's written many books, and he passed away about 1917 or 1918. But he left us a wealth of truth and knowledge. And I want to share with you what he says about humility. We're going to look at him throughout the message today. He says, first of all, humility is perfect quietness of heart. It is to expect nothing. It is to wonder at nothing that is done to me, to feel nothing done against me. It is to be at rest when nobody praises me and when I am blamed or despised. He goes on to say, and when I am blamed or despised, it is to have a blessed home in the Lord. It is literally to be at home in the Lord, where I can go in and shut the door and kneel to my Father in secret and am at peace in the depth of the calmness when all around me is a trouble. You know, here we are, all around us, it seems to be trouble. How do we come and have that peace when it seems like the world is just in a swirl? And again, it's coming and enveloping ourselves in God through humility and getting a place where we can be at home in Him and we can shut the door, kneel down, and we can go to Him and knowing that He is going to look after us. He sort of sums it up in another book called Humility, The Journey Toward Holiness. He says very succinctly, he says, humility is nothing but the disappearance of self in the vision that God is all. I mean, that's very simple as a concept. Humility is nothing but the disappearance of self. Again, as we said last time, it's not thinking lowly of yourself. It's literally not thinking of yourself at all. It's almost erasing self and replacing that with God. Letting God be your focus, letting God be your care, and letting God care for you. In other words, the vision that God is all. And when we do that, our cares and worries and hurts seem to disappear. So as we get into Philippians this afternoon, we want to understand that Paul is continuing with this theme. Because the church at Philippi, one of the reasons he wrote this letter is because there was conflict going on within the church. There was a little bit of disagreement. There was a little bit of dispute. And Paul was writing them to encourage them to be joyful and to set aside that conflict. And he wasn't writing from an ivory tower or a scholarly study. He was writing from a jail cell. So who better to talk about humility than a man who is imprisoned? And so as we get into the book of Philippians, we're going to go to chapter 2, where we left off last time. And we're going to look at verse 12. And I'm going to show you today practical ways to exercise humility in our daily lives. How to do it. We talked about what it is, but now we're going to talk about how to do it. And first of all, I want you to notice that in order to practice humility, we need to first let God perfect in you His salvation. What do I mean by that? Well, Paul says it here in chapter 2, verse 12. He says, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence." And this next line is key. He says, "Work out your own salvation." Now, I want you to notice, let me stop there. He's not saying work for your salvation. He's going to show in a minute that that's the work of God. He's nowhere saying work for your salvation because we cannot work for our salvation. Our salvation is not by works, but it is by grace, the unmerited favor of God, and we receive it through faith, trust, and reliance upon Him. But He says, "Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do His good pleasure." So how do we do that? How do we let God perfect His salvation in us? First of all, we work out what we've been given. I mean, salvation is called a gift throughout Scripture. And you know, if you're a parent, I'm a parent, and my kids are grown now, but when they were little, you would buy them a Christmas present or a birthday present. And it was very frustrating because sometimes they were more interested in the box than what was in the box. And you're a parent, you've gone out, you've hunted, you've found it, you spent the money, and it's laying over on the floor while they play with the box. And what brings you joy is when you give a child or somebody else a gift that they enjoy and that they can use. That's something that will be a blessing to them. And salvation, listen, it's a gift. We didn't have to do anything to get it. We didn't have to earn it. It was given through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. You say, you mean you believe in easy believism? No, I believe in the fact that the salvation gift was bought and paid for. I can't pay for it. It's beyond my means. I'm a sinner just like you. I don't deserve anything. That's why Jesus came to die and provide salvation. And we've been given a gift, and therefore God wants us to do something with it. The gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news of His death, burial, and resurrection, wasn't just for a one-time moment. He gave us a gift. Yes, we're going to enjoy heaven, but He wants us to enjoy that relationship and fellowship with Him now. He wants us to walk with Him, to get to know Him. And so what we do is we work out what we've been given. We do something with it. And not only for ourselves, but we also share that gift with others. We work with what we've been given. We've been given good news. You know, today, good news is, hey, I found toilet paper at Walmart. Let's go get it. You know, that's big news today. People get excited about that. Can you ever imagine the time that we would get excited about toilet paper at Walmart? I mean, that's something we just take for granted. But listen, we've been given good news that death has been conquered, sin has defeated, heaven has been won, and through faith in Jesus Christ, we can go there and be with Him one day. Not only that, but we know that through faith in Jesus Christ, we have a relationship with Him, and He walks with us and lives with us and is in our lives. Yes, even in the midst of this corona pandemic, He is in it with us. You remember the disciples in the boat on the Sea of Galilee when the storm came. Jesus was in the boat with them. And I remind you that He wasn't all that excited about the problem. He was asleep. And so God knows what we're going through. He's going through it with us. And so we need to let God complete, mature, perfect His salvation in us. We need to work out what we've been given. Do something with it. Work with what we've been given. Live in it. Enjoy it. Pour it into our lives. So that way we are humbled before God, so grateful for that gift that we honor Him by making the most of it. That's why Paul says, work out your salvation. Work it out. Not work for it. Not work out to get it, but work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, respecting the giver. And again, he says, for it's God who works in you both to will and to do His good pleasure. It's not our work ultimately. It's God who does it. What we do is we humble ourselves and yield to Him. in order to work out that salvation. We already have salvation, but to make it, to work it out, we get involved in it. We live it and we share it. And so the first thing about being humble is surrendering to God and working out that salvation. Let God perfect in you His salvation. The second concept we're going to look at in this passage is a very simple one. As a matter of fact, it's a very timely one. It basically says, don't complain. I know we're Baptists and many of us are out there and we like to complain. We want to get our two cents in. We want to know how we've been unjustly treated. We want people to know how poorly we've been handled. We get upset. But Paul says this, especially among the people of God. In verse 14, he says, do all things without complaining and disputing. Verse 14 is a simple verse. Do all things. He said all things. And remember, one of my professors, Dr. Fink, said all means all. That's all means. So that means whether we're at work, whether we're at home, whether we're receiving service at a restaurant or a gas station or wherever, even in church, especially in church, in the body of Christ, he says, do all things without complaining and disputing. Now understand, things go wrong. People do things wrong. You might be at a restaurant and you might have ordered a meal and they might have gotten your order wrong. Well, you don't have to complain about it. You just point it out to the waiter or waitress, the server, and say, look, man, you're working hard. I appreciate what you're doing for me, but this isn't quite what I ordered. Is there a way I could get that taken care of? I've seen far too many Christians blow off waiters and waitresses and treat them horribly because they were offended because the waiter got their order wrong. And chances are it wasn't the waiter that did that at all or the waitress. And so, you know, we need to quit complaining. Yes, if we have a problem, we take it to somebody, but we do it graciously, lovingly, and redemptively. I've learned in my life that the better I treat people, the better I'm going to be treated. And so sometimes if I am wronged or if somebody's done something not according to my hopes or specifications, instead of whining and complaining about it, I want to go and talk to them about it. You never know. I might win a friend. Not only in the world outside the church, but in the world in the body of Christ. Sometimes my pastor friends like to kid around that they're the dumpster of complaints in the church. I have one buddy of mine who wanted to put a sign up on his door, complaint department, because every church member, oh, they get mad at this, they get upset at that, somebody moved the potted plant, somebody put the flag on the wrong side, I don't like the hymn that the music guy sang, I don't like the guitars, pastor doesn't wear a tie anymore, the pastor is this, the deacons are that, oh my goodness, it's just phenomenal. You know, listen, let me put things in perspective for you. We have been, remember that gift we talk about, the salvation? We have been given such an amazing gift. We have been given such an amazing gift of salvation, and we've been given such an amazing opportunity to worship Almighty God, to come to a church, to come to a meeting, or to do what we're doing now and be exposed to the wondrous truths of eternity, and to know that God, the creator of all that we see, loves us and will carry us through. What have we got to complain about? I know we're guilty of it sometimes. We all are. But especially in times like this, I think we're learning maybe not to complain so much. Maybe the one of the things God is trying to teach us through all this pandemic is to be grateful for what we have, to be thankful for where we are, and not let the little foolish things in life bother us. And yes, not complaining sometimes means we have to humble ourselves, but isn't that the point? Isn't that the point? So he says, do all things without complaining and disputing, because a couple of reasons. First of all, complaining only causes disputes. He said, do it without complaining and disputing. Why are so many churches in turmoil? Because somebody complained about that person. Somebody complained about this ministry. Somebody whined about that music. And it's a constant battle, a constant struggle. You know, it's a shame that a few years ago, the churches went through what have been called the music wars, because we changed hymns for contemporary music. We really didn't do that. We just blended it. But boy, people, they like to hang on to what they love no matter what. And all the complaining, it was just sad. It was difficult and it was unnecessary. It was unnecessary. We complain about the pastor, the deacons, the Sunday school teachers. I don't like this. I don't like the way the chairs are arranged. I don't like the color of the carpet, the paint on the wall. We get so bent out of shape over the little things in church. You know what I wish somebody would come up and complain to me about? Pastor, we're not talking to enough people about Jesus Christ. Pastor, we're not spending more time in prayer. Pastor, we're not seeking God's face more. Boy, you start complaining about that, you'll put a smile on this pastor's face. But complaining only causes disputes, and it only causes distraction. I mean, I tell you, one of the biggest things about pastoral ministry or in ministry in general is how many pastors, youth pastors, music leaders, worship leaders are leaving the ministry because they're tired of the disputes. They're tired of the distractions, having to chase down and put out fires, having to go after complaints and make everybody happy. Let me say something to you very carefully. I've said it before. The only person that I'm interested in making happy is God Almighty. As far as the people in the congregation, I will serve them, love them, and communicate the Word of God to them. But my role, Aaron Thomas's role, Richard Reed's role, Mike Brooks's role, as leaders in worship and ministry, our job is not to make you happy. Our job is to glorify God Almighty and bring you along with us. So complaining only causes distraction. No, everything's not going to go the way you wanted it to go. No, the church isn't always going to run the way you want it to run. And yes, we're going to make mistakes. We're only human, but whining and complaining doesn't help. Gently, graciously pointing out issues is even more helpful. So don't complain. And yes, that involves humility. You cannot be that way unless you're humble. Not only that, but the third thing is that, which is kind of the opposite, in which if we stop complaining and start surrendering and working out our salvation, Paul says we should shine as beacons of light in a dark world. Look what he says as we continue. He goes on to say this in verse 15. He says, do all things without complaining and disputing. Verse 15, that you may become blameless and harmless. Isn't that an interesting word? They're harmless. You know, it's a shame that Paul actually had to use that word because quite frankly, there are some in the church who literally cause harm. There have been people in churches that literally have split churches. Church bosses, pushy people who want to get their way and they'll step over anybody they can. He says that you may become blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. Notice this next phrase, among whom you shine as lights in the world. Matthew tells us, Jesus in his Sermon on the Mount says we are to reflect the glory and light of God. We are to be a light in the world. Not that we generate that light, but we reflect the light from God. Just like the moon reflects the sunlight and shines in the darkness at night. We need to make sure that we are shining. And so as we look at this, when we do that, we become a contrasting example. Because we live in a world where people are unhappy. We live in a world where people are unsatisfied. I mean, without God, how can you be otherwise? We live in a world where people complain, and that's a big deal. Businesses even have complaint departments. How refreshing would it be if you're somebody who doesn't complain? Somebody who's actually living out what you say you believe. And you become a contrast to other people. I can tell you in my years of ministry, not at this church, but others too, this church as well, is there are always people that when they walk in a room, they lighten the room because you know they love the Lord and they love the church. There are other people, let's be honest, even in the church, that walk in a room and you go, oh, how did they know to come today? There are people that rub you the wrong way. You're saying, oh, pastor, how can you say that? Because that's the reality. There are people, because of their complaining, because of their selfishness, hey, they're unpleasant. They're difficult to be around. But man, when you have somebody who surrendered to the Lord and who doesn't complain but rolls with it and works in grace and love, they're a bright spot. It's what one evangelist I heard, and I've lost his name, but he says that we should be refreshers for God. We should refresh people. And when we are shining in God's light, and yes, that takes humility, because more often than not, we're worried about our own light. We're worried about our own glory. But when we're shining and reflecting God's light, we're a contrast to those people who aren't. And we'll stand out. And when we stand out, it's not because we want to stand out and have fame or glory. It's because we want to draw people to the light of Almighty God. So when you shine as a beacon of light in a dark world, you become a contrasting example. But not only that, a constant encouragement. I can't tell you as a pastor how encouraging people like that are to me. They refresh my spirit. They refresh my soul. They bring lightness and brightness to me, and I appreciate that. And I'm sure the other leaders in our church could go along with that. It's difficult for pastoral leaders and ministry leaders to deal with disputes and struggles when people are trying to get their own way. How refreshing it is when people put themselves aside, put others first. Man alive, those are the people that bring life and vitality to a ministry. So we need to be a constant encouragement. We will be if we shine as lights in a dark world. Another concept in this whole aspect of practical humility is that, and this is something we really need to focus on every day, but especially now, and that is to hold on to the word of life. Look what Paul goes on to say. He says, down in verse 16, he says, holding fast the word of life. What is that? That's the word of God, the scriptures. Holding them fast, it literally means to grasp them to yourself, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain and labored in vain. Paul said, if you'll hold on to the word of God and live it out and trust it and carry it and surrender to it, that would bring him as their pastor joy. I mean, he worked hard, he risked his life, and he's even in prison for the communication of the gospel. And sending them money is nice, but the ultimate joy, sending him help is nice, but the ultimate joy is when he sees God's people living out the message that he's proclaimed to them and trusting in the word that he shared with them. And listen, we need to hold fast to the word because life is changing. I mean, who would have thought just 2 weeks ago that we would not be having worship service in our building? Who would have thought that so many people would be losing jobs and out of work, restaurants closing, all kinds of places cutting back hours, not going out, stay 6 feet from people. I mean, who'd have thought this world would be the way it is now just a couple, 3 weeks ago? Yeah, the world changes. Let me tell you something. The only thing that doesn't change in life is change. We talked about on our Wednesday night thing the fact that we need to hold on to God. He doesn't change. Hold on to the word of life. First of all, it's a banner of hope. We have the promises of God. Listen, the world changes, but the promises of God don't. The fact that God loves us never changes. I wrote in an article that I put online that God, in Hebrews 13:8, God in His Word tells us there that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Yes, our world is changing, and yes, it's difficult. And yes, we're a little frightened, maybe a little angry. But God isn't changing. God's love is still sure. His word is still true. And that is a banner of hope. Not only that, but it's also a blessing and a help. I tell you, there are times as we're going through this that, man, I get a little discouraged. I'll be honest with you, there are times I look around and think, my word, goodness, what's going to happen? But I run back to the word of God. For the word of God reminds me that God is in control. The word of God blesses me in the promises that God has given. And I know that one way or another, we're going to be all right. And so that is a blessing and a help right now. I can't imagine what life is like for people who don't know the Lord in this whole mess. I can't imagine what hope they're clinging to. Our leaders are doing the best job they can. Our president, our Congress, our mayor, our governor, finally, they all seem like they're coming together and they're doing the best job that they can. But my hope is not in them. My hope is not in a cure for the coronavirus. My hope is not in the fact that the stores have enough food. My hope is to be in God Almighty, who will take care of those things in His good time. So we need to humble ourselves. And yes, it is humbling, because we want to figure it out. But I love Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6 that says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. And here's the next line in chapter 3, verse 5 in Proverbs, and lean not unto your own understanding. In other words, don't try to figure it out. Just trust the Lord. Hang on to Him and His Word. It goes on to say, in all your ways acknowledge Him. In other words, give Him glory. Give Him praise. Look to Him. Look to His Word. And it says, and He will straighten and smooth your paths. It's a promise of God. It's in His Word. I don't know about you, but that brings me tremendous comfort when I can't understand it or figure it out. And I appreciate that. So hold on to the word of life. And yes, that means you got to humble yourself. Instead of trying to figure out the answers yourself, you're just going to have to say, I don't understand it. And I'll be honest with you, I don't understand why this is happening. I don't understand why God is allowing it to happen. Did He cause it? Is He allowing it? I don't understand it. And quite frankly, I don't really like it. But that doesn't matter. God knows what He's doing. God has allowed it or God has caused it for whatever His purpose. And I need to trust in the Lord with all my heart, lean not unto my own understanding, and let God, as I acknowledge Him, straighten and smoothen my path. So hold on to the Word of life. And then finally, not only all those other things that we talked about, but the last concept in this passage that deals with working out humility is that we should rejoice with those who sacrifice. Rejoice with those who sacrifice. Look what Paul said as he finishes this portion of Scripture. He said, "Yes, and I am being poured out as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service of your faith." Paul was basically saying, my life is just poured out. There's nothing left of me. I've given everything I am and I have to the sake of the gospel and to you, Philippian church, so that you might be strengthened and established in Christ. He literally has sacrificed everything short of his life in order to bring glory. If that's not humility, I don't know what is. He said, I'm being poured out, and he's sacrificing. He goes on to say this, I am glad. Did you hear that? I am glad and rejoice with you all. Here is a man, again, we've emphasized it so many times, he's in prison. He's in prison because he's preached and taught the gospel. He's in prison because he's told people that God loves them, Jesus died for them, and he saved them. And his life, you talk about a sacrifice. You know, we have it way better than Paul did, even though we're in the midst of a pandemic. And he said, yet I'm glad and I rejoice with you all because I've been able to minister to you and you're growing and thriving in your faith. You've got issues, but we're going to work them out. He says in verse 18, for the same reason, look at this, you also be glad and rejoice with me. I mean, can you imagine? I mean, it sounds almost silly. Woohoo, Paul's in prison. I mean, that's not what he's talking about. He's talking about them rejoicing and being glad that you had someone that loved you so much. First of all, Jesus, who gave everything. But secondly, you had men and women like Paul, who gave everything so that they might be established in the faith. So rejoice with those who sacrifice. We need to find joy in sacrifice. And yes, we're being called upon to sacrifice. And some people, it's going to be hard and it's going to be a struggle. And I tell you, my heart goes out to folks. It really does. And we need to do everything we can to support them, stand by them, and encourage them. But if you and I are sacrificing, we need to somehow find some joy in it. Maybe we don't take as much from the grocery store so that somebody else could have enough. There's a lot of joy in that kind of sacrifice. Maybe we sacrifice some time to go check on a family member or a friend if it's safe to do that. We need to find joy in sacrifice. You know, that's what the church needs to do. If we found joy in sacrificing some of the things that we have so that others might come to know Jesus, man, that's what joy is. I remember when I was a youth leader and I sat on a bench when I did youth work in Tampa and all the teenagers sat on rug squares in front of me. And I remember when I would have the meeting and there'd be kids who'd bring their friends with them from school to hear the gospel. And I remember I would do the invitation. I'd say, bow your heads and close your eyes. And I would offer an invitation and ask them to raise their hands if they're receiving Christ as Savior. I know who had their eyes open peeking. Because I'd look at the room and you'd see a hand go up. Somebody coming to know Jesus, trusting Jesus and wanting me to pray for them as they're doing that. And their friend who brought them is just, man, they're peeking and they're celebrating. They're enjoying that. What joy it is. I bet it took a lot of sacrifice for some of these kids to bring their friends. But I tell you, there is no greater joy than to see someone come to know Jesus. And even though it cost Paul his freedom and his liberty and his material possessions, he was glad and rejoicing, finding joy in sacrifice. Because the reason why is he was furnishing joy through sacrifice. Because he had sacrificed, people were coming to know Christ. Because he had sacrificed, the church was growing in Christ. Because he had sacrificed, there were relationships with God that might never have happened. You know, we at church, we're oftentimes talking about, oh, we got to watch our budget. Oh, we can't, you know, I'm busy. I can't give this much time. Oh, we can't do this. We can't. We need to start thinking in terms of humility and sacrifice. By the way, the word sacrifice is a Latin word, which means making something God's. Making something God's. Paul was able to pour out his life. Paul was able to lose his freedom because at the end of the day, Paul was so humble that he realized it wasn't his life anymore. It belonged to God. That's true humility. I don't see myself anymore. It's not about me anymore. It's about God. I am lost in His vision. I am enveloped in His love and care. And my life now is God. And if it means I have to sacrifice it in one way or another to bring someone to Christ, to bring joy to somebody else, man, that's wonderful. And listen, we already experience a little of this, especially those of you who have been or are parents. You sacrifice, if you're a good parent, you sacrifice time and energy and money to bring joy to your kids, to take care of your kids, to raise them up to be good people. And what joy you feel. I'll never forget the first time I saw one of my children. I was looking through the window of the living room, and I watched them with their mother's Sunday school curriculum leading their friend to Jesus Christ. Man alive, I had a revival fit right there in my own room. And I didn't want to embarrass them. I didn't go out and interrupt them. But it was such a wonderful thing. I remember when Andy had a lot of the youth over our house when they did youth Bible studies, and he was involved in that. And I remember sitting in the family room next to the window, and they were out on our back deck. And either Andy or one of the other guys was teaching the lesson. And the preacher in me wanted to go out and help them. I was sitting there going, I couldn't sit still. But what a joy it was to hear these guys communicating God's word. And, you know, whoever parents, they sacrifice. Man, that's the only true joy that we can really just get our teeth into, is when we sacrifice and something good comes from it. So we rejoice with those who sacrifice. So again, by review, how do we live out humility? Well, we let God perfect His salvation in us. We work it out. We've been given a gift. Now let's do something with it. Well, let's do something with it. Let's work it out in our lives. And also, let's work with what we've been given. Let's go out and share the gospel. Not only that, but we need to quit complaining. We just need to stop. It doesn't help. I can't stand whining. I never allowed my children to whine. If you got a problem, come tell me. We'll work it out. But don't complain. Don't whine. Just get through it. It's not as bad as we probably think it is anyway. Shine as beacons of light in a dark world. Humility causes us to put Jesus first, others second, and ourselves last. And when we do that, listen, you will shine, you will become a refresher, and you will become a blessing in ways that you cannot even imagine. You'll stand out in a crowd of whining complainers, and you'll be in a constant encouragement to leaders and to Christian friends. And to do that, we need to hold on to the truth. We need to hold fast the word of life. It is our banner of hope in this mess. It is a blessing and a help. How often we ignore it, and we ignore it to our own peril. And finally, yeah, we need to rejoice with those who sacrifice. You know, I appreciate those on Facebook who are thanking the truck drivers and the medical workers and the police officers and the grocery store stock clerks and all these people who are going out to do the things so that we might have enough. Boy, tell those people thank you. Rejoice with their sacrifice. And that's how we live it out. That's the practical way of living out humility. That's what Paul was trying to communicate to the church in Philippi. Again, going back to Andrew Murray, because he's so good, so clear on this subject. He says, here is the path to the higher life. You know, we think of the higher life as going from mountaintop to mountaintop. But you know what? In order to get to the mountaintop, what do you got to do? You got to go to the valley. You just can't jump from mountaintop to mountaintop. Only Superman can do that, and he doesn't exist. I mean, you can't do that. You have to go through the valley. And that's why he said, here's the path to the higher life. He says, it's down, lower down. He says, just as water always seeks and fills the lowest place, so the movement of God finds men abased and empty. His glory and power flow in to exalt and to bless. In other words, if we're constantly puffing ourselves up, constantly pushing ourselves on others, constantly sharing our 2 cents worth, constantly trying to get our way, have our way, God's not going to need to pick us up. It is when we allow ourselves to be humbled, when we allow ourselves to be low and to be lowly, then God will lift us up. That's what He did with Jesus. We saw that in the last passage. In Philippians 2, 5 through 11, Jesus was humbled to the point of pain, and humiliation and humbling is painful. But God was able to raise Him and exalt Him. And that's what Paul is trying to communicate. And I want to end with the passage I ended with last week. It's James chapter 4, verse 10. And it's so simple, but so profound. It's so short in its printing, but so long in its wisdom. And if we could only get a handle of this, not only will it make going through this pandemic easier and better, but it will also, after this pandemic is over, and it will end, it will help us to be a better, stronger church. And I'll tell you, as pastor, that's what I'm hoping happens. I'm hoping through all this that I'll be a better, stronger man, a better, stronger father, a better, stronger Christian. I hope through all this that West Concord will be a better, stronger church than we've ever been before. This isn't hurting us. This isn't hindering us. God is using us. But he says this, and it's very simple, but very profound. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will, not he might, not may, he will lift you up. You will never experience the uplifting of God until you humble yourself down. And that's the reality of it. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that you humbled the Lord Jesus Christ, God in the flesh. He went through human existence, feeling everything we feel, living as a man, limited, struggling with physical issues as we do, until, Father, he was tortured and cruelly crucified on an agonizing cross. And we went through all the pain that caused. But Father, you raised him up from the dead. Now he sits at your right hand, and you've exalted him above every name and above everything. And Father, we thank you for salvation that you provide that way. We thank you through Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, and by doing so took the blame for our sins. He paid a price that he didn't know, but we couldn't pay. And Father, he was buried, and 3 days later, he rose again from the dead. Lord, I pray that everyone who is watching this video, everyone who is hearing this message, I pray that they know Jesus as Savior. But if they don't, I pray that they would shut off their device, turn off their computer, get on their knees, and Father, confess and admit their sin, and fall upon Jesus as their Savior. Abandon religion, abandon reformation, Lord. Abandon any effort to try to save themselves. None of us can be good enough. But Father, I pray that they would fall completely and fully upon you with their faith, trusting in Jesus as their Savior, believing that he died for their sin, believing he was buried and rose again from the dead. And I pray that they'll trust him and him alone to take them to heaven. And Father, I pray for my brothers and sisters who know Christ as Savior. Father, start with me. Lord, I believe you're humbling this world. I believe you're humbling your church. Father, help us to lean into that. Help us to let you do that. Help us to put ourselves last, Jesus first, and then others. And Father, we'll begin to experience the joy. Help us to quit complaining and start encouraging. Father, help us, instead of being a dark patch in the world, help us to shine with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Help us to bring good news in a world of bad news. And Father, you will bless. Lord, I love my congregation. Those who are listening and watching, even outside the congregation, Lord, they're special, they're precious. Father, bless each family, bless each person listening. And Father, we pray that you will be glorified. And we ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.